Welcome to this practice transformation webinar. Today we have Dr. Joe Shapiro, who's an associate professor in otolaryngology, head and neck surgery at Harvard Medical School. She's also a senior faculty for the Center for Medical Simulation in Boston.
I'm so honored to be able to do this work with you all, and we're going to spend about a half hour together in going over some of the important principles of peer support, why it's needed, and some of the basics of how to do it, and then also speaking about operationalizing it, really making sure that we're concentrating on being able to do this in the current reality of the pandemic. Everything I talk about is really generalizable to peer support in other situations, and so the principles will stay the same, but at this point I think we needed some concentration on how to be available to each other in this particular time. So I also want to thank the AMA for letting me work with you all. I put the quote up from Parker Palmer, who's an activist and educator, about how much institutions really matter. And peer support, I think, is a an organizational approach and an individual approach, both, to being there for each other. So when we think about our organizations and when we think about the way we practice medicine, I think we need to remind ourselves of the fact that medicine, the culture of medicine, is very strong, and we've all been sort of raised in similar ways medically, and much of the culture is wonderful, like the fact that we're healers and we put our patients first. That is beautiful, and no one will ever take that from us. But as I point out here, there is a dark side to this. The culture has in some ways let us down. It's over years, it's been increasing our workload without actually increasing the support to frontline clinicians, for example. We've been taught that that our physical, mental, and emotional needs are not important. And generally speaking, I think the system has set us up to really not recognize the humanity in us or each other. So that's partly why I think that peer support is so important, but also I think will help change the culture. I put this slide of all these logos of places I've been to just remind myself to mention that the culture of medicine, from what I understand, and I've been to many different types of organizations, some in other countries, many across the US, and I'm very respectful of microculture differences. But I also have noticed how consistent the culture of medicine is across all these organizations. And this will come up a lot in peer support, because I think a lot of our suffering comes from the downside of the culture that we've all been raised in. So I wanted to have us think, where does peer support fit into the well-being continuum? And it doesn't actually fit into this pie chart perfectly, but I think it's a good way for us to think about some of the problems we've had in conceptualizing well-being. And one of them, I think, is that there was an over-focus on personal resilience. That is, it's on each of our individual shoulders to be exercising, eating well, meditating, yoga, just take care of yourself. And that's problematic for several reasons, one of which is that the culture really doesn't support giving us the time or space to do that. And I think more importantly, we have to realize that there's so many things we're experiencing that really are about how our system is serving us or not, and how that's serving our being able to be there for our patients. So I think this idea that we need to look at organizational aspects is really important. I would say the culture of wellness, I wouldn't put as a separate pie slice. I would say the culture is part of all of this pie. So to put a fine point on it, I'd say for many years, our system has treated us as an inexhaustible resource, and we've internalized that. That's what we're meant to do, is to be that inexhaustible resource. I think the COVID epidemic in particular has put an extraordinary burden on physicians and other healthcare team members and administrators and leaders, a burden that is cognitive, physical, and also emotional. And I ask this rhetorically, is how are we expected to sustain our work if we don't address these challenges to our well-being? So of course, peer support is going to be open, be a time to people, for people to open up around what is causing them stress. And it will be some operational issues, and it will also be some emotional issues, and we'll talk about that. I look at support as a spectrum, especially emotional peer support, as a spectrum from informal peer support to formal peer support to people who need actually further resources such as mental health or advice from risk management or management of addiction or other substance use disorders. So what I'm focusing on in the webinar is more about the formal peer support, but I'll talk at the end about how informal and peer support and further resources can be integrated. When I do peer support training, one of the questions I ask the participants is if they can reflect on some of the emotions that they've been experiencing during this pandemic. And I have gotten just many, many people sharing what they're going through, and there's certain themes to what I've heard and my colleagues have expressed in one-on-one peer support or group peer support. Before we dive into those thematic concerns that I've been hearing, I put this up to remind us something that the first responders who trained our group originally years ago, over 10 years ago, where they said that we all walk around with a backpack, and when we come across something difficult in our lives, it's like a rock that we put in our backpack, and we walk along and there's another rock, and it kind of keeps getting fuller and fuller in our backpack. And then we're walking along and there's a rock. It's not the biggest one we have, but we put it in our backs, and it's just too hard to hold that backpack, and we need to put it down. So I say this just to remind ourselves that though I'm going to talk about thematic reactions, of course, when you're supporting your peer, you don't know which of those reactions they have. And that's why it's very important to be fully present for your peer to understand what they are going through. So these are the ways I've conceptualized some of the reactions that I'm hearing from our colleagues who are in this pandemic full out. One is a sense of grief, loss, grief, and that's can be pretty profound. So, you know, one, we're just, there's people are seeing so much illness and death that's out of the, beyond the scale of what we're used to seeing. We're seeing families separated from their sick and even dying loved ones. That's very hard to watch, of course. I think we have feelings of helplessness. Are we doing enough? Can we do more? And many times we can't. We worry about abandoning our families. We have, in some cases, had to do that by living in different residences from them. And I think there's also this loss of connection from our colleagues, both physical and emotional, which is we just can't. Someone said, I just miss being able to give my colleague a hug at the end of the day, or just sit in a group together and, you know, just be with each other in meetings and those sorts of things. So there's some loss that's happened for sure. I think guilt is there. Guilt is really prominent. I found that in peer support, whether you're peer supporting for the pandemic or for all sorts of things, errors or many other stressors, guilt is very prominent. And to explore that a little, I put this under the heading of the culture and systems that we inherited and that we sort of bought into. One is that we're supposed to be strong, and strong means denying our needs. That has been the definition of strong. Another is that we feel guilty because some of our colleagues are doing much harder work right now. They're in much closer contact with COVID patients, or they're working longer shifts or hours, have more responsibilities, and so we feel like, well, my suffering is nothing compared to there, so I really don't have a right to that. I think generally we also compare our physical, mental, and emotional needs to our patients, families, and the communities. And of course, many times they seem to pale in comparison. And I think we've been taught over many, many years that self-care for healthcare providers is selfish, and that self-compassion is selfish. And of the argument, of course, and this has been borne out by the literature way before the pandemic started, is that that's just not true. But this is what we've inherited. So, and the last one I have here is this feeling like if I attend to my needs, will that put more work or burden on my colleagues' needs? And sometimes the system has set it up such that that's true. And I think that's problematic, and we need to identify that so people are allowed to take a break and they don't, that doesn't get put to double work on somebody else. This is from a physician, Adam Hill, who wrote a book called Long Walk Out of the Woods. And I picked this quote from the book because I think it's very apt. We are indoctrinated into a system that functions on the belief that others' needs are the sole priority. I put my own needs on the back burner because that seemed to be what the profession required. And I had done this for so long, I forgot how to even assess my own needs at all. This comes up with peer support when we ask our colleagues about their needs, and they just have said, I really haven't had time to even think of what those might be. Another thing I think people are feeling is a fear and anxiety. Will I have to withhold care from my patients to ration care? Will I get sick and be unable to provide for my family? Will I get my family sick? Can I keep up with these constant changes? Am I competent to do this new work assignment if I've been redeployed into another area? Can I sustain this burden that I'm feeling? And then I think the question we're all asking is, when will this all end? I think on the heels of fear and anxiety can come some resentment and anger. And I want to call those out because I think they're real and fair to say. And one is the fact that we really haven't been protected. Healthcare workers have been put into situations in a way that's been very unsafe. And that's just a failure of our systems, including, you know, our government. And I think we just have to acknowledge that, and that the resources that we should have now and should have had have not always been present, and that's really problematic. Another is that we're sometimes, by the nature of this, by the way it's been handled, is we're being given contradictory information. Do this for your patients, do that, get tested for yourself, don't get tested. And that's hard. That can make people feel frustrated and angry even. And sometimes there's been a lack of transparency about what's really happening, what the statistics are, what the needs are. And I think whenever there's no transparency, or whenever there's a lack of transparency, you're going to get people angry. It's a very natural reaction to that, because it really violates trust. I think just the work hours have been brutal for some people, and that's problematic. Many people have been forced to practice outside of their zone of competence, as I mentioned earlier, and that can be upsetting to people. And I think, as I mentioned before, it really breeds cynicism and anger, and then cynicism if we're told that we're supposed to take care of ourselves, we're offered all these personal well-being tips, but we actually don't have the culture or the system or the space or time to do those, to do that self-care. And, you know, I put the isolation and exhaustion, you know, clearly from all this. We are literally more isolated than we've ever had to be. I think it's important also to look at gratitude. Gratitude, I think if we think about it, a lot of us feel very grateful, and grateful even during this pandemic, and maybe especially during it because of all the beautiful things people have been doing for each other and including for us. And I think that gratitude is important. What I see healthcare providers struggle with is this idea that it's okay to hold both those, the grief and all those other negative emotions, if you will, and gratitude at the same time. They are both real. One does not negate the other. And I think that's hard for us to do sometimes. So I'm going to now describe some of the foundations of what peer support is. And these are really the three foundations. One is your focused, loving presence for your colleague. And that sounds like kind of a throwaway, but actually, if you've ever been supported by anybody and that person is really giving their full, caring attention to you, in and of itself, that feels incredibly wonderful. And so that is the basis of peer support. being able to do that. And it doesn't mean an hour conversation. It can be even a brief one where that person who's supporting you is really there for you. The other is emotional intelligence, so that you can both manage as the peer supporter your own emotions, but also be attuned to what your peer is saying, either verbally or non-verbally. And then this comes up a lot for good peer support, and that is engaging in a conversation where you're using non-judgmental curiosity to help your peer explore a bit more about why they're feeling what they're feeling and their own solutions for actually managing that. So the peer support fundamentals include the first outreach, the invitation to say, is this something you'd like? And it has to be, I think, put out there in a way that it's destigmatizing. It's not like we're just calling people who we know are really, really not handling things well, right? We don't want that. We want to make it that we're checking in on you. We're offering peer support because that's what we do. This is a routine part of now what we do. And so the invitation needs to be given in that way. The other, of course, peer support, once you're starting a peer support conversation, is that kind of empathic listening that I was talking about, where you're really hearing what the peer is going through. And then based on whatever they say, reflecting with the peer about what they're feeling, what they're experiencing, and reflecting in terms of normalizing their emotions, because you won't be surprised to hear that most of the things that people say, many of us have experienced. And that's really important for people not to feel like they're just totally crazy. And then the other is to validate it and say, look, this is, it's totally understandable that given what you just told me you were asked to do or you had to witness, that you would feel that way. That really makes sense. You're caring and compassionate. Makes sense that you would feel that way. And then sharing your experience when it's relevant. And I think there's this tension between, you don't want to overshare because you're really there to support the peer, but sometimes, you know, if you've had a similar experience or had some kind of way to connect with the peer you're supporting, it is perfectly appropriate to share to a degree. And I think reframing is also important, and that is helping the peer put their emotions in context and also put their weave into that the positive part of what they do. The tricky part of this is you don't want to minimize their emotions, but you do want to help them see all the good that they're doing. And I think that reframing is really important. And it's somewhat tricky to do, but it's really key. It's helpful to encourage learning and teaching, so people are learning and growing every day, pandemic or not, but especially now where there's so much new information. And I'm encouraging people to share what they've learned and helping their colleagues really not just get through this, but actually take better care of patients. I think that feels good for us anytime we learn and then share that learning. A key part of peer support is actually helping the peer pull on whatever coping mechanisms that they have used in the past or even that they're currently using. And this, interestingly or paradoxically, we often find that the coping mechanisms that the peer uses, normally they've stopped using during this especially stressful time. And I think there should be a gentle help for the peer to realize that this is such an important time to care for themselves and to use their support systems, rely on their friends and family, their colleagues to help them through. We all need support. We all deserve support. Connecting people with other resources is important. Sometimes peer support is absolutely not enough. And we know healthcare providers, especially physicians, do not usually access mental health or other kinds of support. And so one of the wonderful aspects of peer support is offering those resources to any of our peers and saying, you know, sometimes it's just our circumstances have it so that we are especially stressed. And if they need further support or want further support, you as a peer supporter are happy to connect them with someone who can help them further. And then at the end, you closing and thanking people for taking the time to share what they're going through. Let's talk about operationalizing. What would this actually look like? So there's basically two kinds of peer support. There's peer support for groups of clinicians, and then there's peer support for individuals. The principles of peer support are the same, regardless of context and setting, but it'll look just a little bit different depending on whether you're heading up a group or actually giving peer support to one colleague in particular. These statistics come from a study that I was involved in where we were actually studying physicians and asking about emotional stressors. This was several years ago. And we asked a specific question of, like, if you wanted support, what would be the barriers to your getting support? And you can imagine these were things that you might feel as well: lack of time, stigma, lack of confidentiality, and how do I even get a hold of this support? How do I access it? So when you are building a program, you need to think about what those cultural and systems barriers are and then help people overcome them. And so I believe the way to help them overcome some of those concerns is peer support should be a reach out and proactive. Now, of course, if a peer contacts a peer supporter or somebody and says, I need help, then that's a response to that peer. But I think it's unfair to put the burden on individual clinicians to seek help because of all the cultural and systems barriers to doing so. And I also think it's wrong to wait till people manifest stress. And some people have said, oh, you know, this might result, the pandemic is going to result in post-traumatic stress disorder. Well, it might, but also what if we did some preventative, proactive measures to help prevent that from happening? And then, of course, treat it if it does happen. So virtual versus in-person, I think with depending on the clinical situation, sometimes this can be offered in person, but of course we're using virtual a lot more here. This is just a reminder that peer support, and I've done hundreds of peer supports, it is absolutely doable through either even the phone or video. To have the best army of peer supporters, I think it's best to train. And I'll explain why I think training peer supporters is a good idea. As clinicians, we tend to fall into a trap of minimizing our peers' pain, trying to fix their pain because we're used to fixing our patients' problems. And this is not a situation where you can fix your colleagues' pain. So peer support training is about minimizing pitfalls and teaching people how to focus their attention without trying to be perfect, but how to be present for their colleagues. And then how to have a balance between listening and sharing, because these are not necessarily things that we're used to doing in the clinical realm. So that's why I think training is really important. I think, as I mentioned before, peer support should be set up so that if a clinician asks for help, peer support is available as an option. In addition, you could have a more routine reaching out to colleagues. For example, a trained peer supporter could reach out to those in their division just generally, or in particular, if there's someone who seems stressed, just proactively reaching out to them. One group I'm working with is doing a peer support reach out to any quarantined clinicians. They seem to be feeling pretty stressed, so a normalized reach out to them is helpful. And I think that using virtual team or group peer support is a wonderful way to be able to offer peer support to people in a group environment. There is a lot of power in having a facilitated discussion with other clinicians because people will start to open up and then share what they're going through, and then the colleagues feel more empowered to share what they're going through and to support each other. I think informal peer support, which is where you check in with your peer and say, how's it going for you? What was the shift like today? Or what's the past week been like for you? And then specifically saying, is there anything that's particularly stressing you? Is there anything that's brought you joy? Asking specific questions. And this can be done integrated in the processes that are already set up, which is many teams are doing briefing and debriefing. And so the debriefing, for example, a moment can be devoted to just checking in with how people are actually handling the day or the week or the clinic or whatever the clinical setting is. But it's different from just opening up these moments, briefing, checking in, and debriefing for operational concerns. Those are really important, and we're a little more comfortable doing that. It wouldn't take much, though, to add an opening at any of these moments for saying, I just wonder how people's stress levels are. And then maybe the debrief leader says something like, I could tell you today when I, you know, saw X, Y, or Z, I found that particularly stressful. And it doesn't have to generate, you know, a long discussion. In fact, most situations, it's not going to be able to. And the other operational integration of peer support could be during I think a lot of people are having weekly meetings where the group is virtually meeting, and you could integrate a question about checking in with how people are doing and maybe sharing something. So it doesn't have to be a standalone, which I talked about with virtual peer support. It can be integrated into what we're already doing, just has to be done explicitly. As I mentioned earlier, some people are going to need, and everybody deserves to know about and access further resources. It could be mental health, employee assistance program, social work, chaplaincy for people with, for physicians in particular with substance use. There's most states have physician health services where they can be treated and their license can be protected. Sometimes people actually need to talk to someone in risk management, patient safety, or touch base with their clinical leaders. And I think we should all make sure that our peers have these resources at hand. And if we're providing formal peer support or any kind of peer support, making a mention of the fact that there are these further resources and that the peer supporter can either do the connecting or just give them the peer the information so they can connect themselves. And in closing, as I mentioned earlier, I do believe that we're going to do better as we improve the culture, as we work towards recognizing that our physical, mental, and emotional needs are human and basic, and we need to meet them. And I don't mean like every day everything has to be perfect or in the middle of a code we have to think about ourselves, not at all. But to suppress this, to put our needs aside for a long period of time, which is the way I think the culture has suggested we do this, that's untenable, and there's plenty of data to support that. I think we go from this expectation that we signed up for difficult work and seeing difficult clinical things and we're just supposed to handle it. I think peer support says, actually, your reactions are normal. That's normal. You feel that way because you're caring and compassionate, not because you're weak. I think the isolation, the physical but also emotional, that we have had in medicine generally, and especially I think now because of the pandemic, peer support actually helps us reconnect and gives us back this feeling of solidarity. We're in this together, and it's really important for us to remind ourselves that we are. And then, as I've been mentioning, this idea that self-care is selfish is untrue. And I think the best quote I've heard about this came from my colleague Meg Gaines, who's a teaches patient communication, patient physician communication, is you can't give what you don't have. You can't really give to others if you are not whole. And even if you could, we deserve having our needs met. And I think that humanity is really important to come back to. I wanted to read a poem because it really does, even though it wasn't written about peer support, it reminds me of the importance of it. And it's by Naomi Shihab Nye. A man crosses the street in rain, stepping gently, looking two times north and south because his son is asleep on his shoulder. No car must splash him. No car drive too near to his shadow. This man carries the world's most sensitive cargo, but he's not marked. Nowhere does his jacket say, fragile, handle with care. His ear fills up with breathing. He hears the hum of a boy's dream deep inside him. we're not going to be able to live in this world if we're not willing to do what he's doing with one another. The road will only be wide. The rain will never stop falling. I just feel like that captures what we are, what we have been doing for each other, and then what peer support, I think, as other solutions, can help us really emphasize. I'd like to also emphasize that I've never called peer support a second victim program because I don't think we are victims. I think victims really has a negative stance. And I think that Parker Palmer quote, he wasn't talking about peer support, but I think it speaks to that. I think we do have a lot of agency. There's a lot we can do and are doing for each other. And I feel that this is a very positive way of thinking about how we can support each other. And I want to close by thanking you for your engagement and commitment. And I want to say it even more explicitly. Thank you all for everything you have done and you are doing. It is of value, and we do care about you and each other. And thanks for taking the time to learn more about this.
Thank you, Dr. Shapiro. For general questions, please email the Practice Transformation Team at practice.transformation@ama-assn.org. For additional resources to support your physicians and staff during this time, please visit the American Medical Association website. Additionally, the American Medical Association has developed Coping with COVID surveys, which are brief light touch surveys that practices and institutions can deploy monitor the stress levels within their organization during this pandemic. For more information, visit clinician.health.